one of the amazing things with COVID was that how different countries reacted in different ways according to local cultures and according to local disciplines. Even though it was a common disease, a common virus, countries behaved differently as a result of it, which was interesting and in many cases frustrating for some countries to see that their own country was behaving in a different way than the others. The first question I'd ask the panel is, do you consider now that COVID is past? Has it gone away? Has it finished?
Oh, well, in the Philippines, we have the health authorities who keep telling us that no, it hasn't gone away. The statistics have shown, for example, in the last, I've been monitoring this because in our gated community, I'm in charge of the health and security. So I've been monitoring on a daily basis the COVID cases in Metro Manila. And basically, maybe last month, I'm talking about September, it was averaging something like about 3,000, 4,000 a day. These past 2 weeks, it's been averaging about 1,900 or something. I mean, 1,900 or 800. So it has substantially gone down. Another thing, as far as I'm concerned, is the positivity rate. That means for every person who catches it, how many times has it spread. About 2 months ago, it was averaging about 15%. And these last 2 weeks, it's been averaging less than 8%. So,
the trend is good.
I believe another thing is, I've also been monitoring and encouraging a lot of our neighbors to have all their boosters, shots, and everything. And because I've noticed that the booster centers are basically empty. It's not unlike in the early parts of, or in the latter parts of 2020 and most of the 2021, where all these vaccination centers with so many lines, it take you 1-2 hours just to get vaccinated. Now, if you want to get a booster shot, you can in and out in less than 5 minutes. In other words, I believe most people are already boosted. And I was telling some people before, just over lunch, that I myself is over vaccinated. My first two vaccines were the Chinese Sinovac. So after a year, when the Pfizer and the Moderna became available in the Philippines, which became available after a year and a half, I got myself not boosted. I got myself pre-vaccinated, which a lot of people did. So I got another two vaccination. And then I got a booster. So I now have 5 vaccine shots. And I believe most of my friends did the same thing. So, I'll just tell you about my example. In our community, which I'm in charge of, there are people who would get COVID, but before I would send them, if you get sick, I'd send you what we call a COVID kit, which would have complete medicines, everything you needed. Well, not just medicines, masks, virgin coconut oil, everything that we've asked the doctor what's needed. Now, when somebody has a COVID, I'd ask them, do you need anything? They'll say, no, because they just tested positive, but they don't feel anything. It's not even as bad as a flu because they don't feel bad. The only problem is they have to be isolated. So they get so frustrated that they don't feel bad, but they cannot get out of their room for 7 days. So that's the only problem. So yes, I believe it's going away.
screenshot of their rapid antigen test yesterday to tell me they had COVID and they had no symptoms. But I think for us now as a country, historically the whole house would then have to lock down because someone had COVID, whereas now the mandate and regulations around kind of lockdowns and what you have to do have changed slightly. It's recommended that you stay home whilst you're positive, but your family can still go to work and still kind of get on with their day. So I think it's more so become part of life today. And I think it's interesting to watch people still in social circumstances where you can see people queuing up for the supermarket and you can still consciously see that people maybe aren't leaving the 1.5 metre gap that they had to during COVID, but they're still spaced out and leaving a gap when they're lining up with their groceries rather than standing right on top of each other. So I think there's common courtesies and things that people learn because of COVID, but I think as a business, we kind of adapted and as sort of an Australian culture, we just kind of got on with it.
India, is it, you consider it finished?
I guess COVID will never ever disappear because that's the nature of the virus, but I think that the impact of COVID on daily life is completely gone, pretty much.
But I guess the most important for us is, do the SMBs consider it? Are they now behaving as they were pre-COVID?
Well, let me speak about the Philippines, is that I doubt it. See, right now, many of the SMBs who have closed down or resized significantly, they don't look at it anymore as a COVID. As far as it's now a problem of how are they going to regain whatever they lost. So it's not a question of, because whether COVID is there or not, they still have no problem now that all of a sudden about 50 or 60 employees is now left with about just 3 employees, just him, his secretary, and his driver or something like that. Yeah. So how do you survive? Those that, that completely closed down, how do you revive the company? It's not a question of just that the COVID's gone, but really how do you fix the issue that the COVID caused?
I think for us, or for a small business owner, COVID per se wasn't necessarily the impact, but the impact was on supply chain issues. The impact was on labour and skill shortages. So the impacts for a small business owner were different throughout the pandemic, and I think those impacts have continued on as we speak today and will probably flow on for kind of for some years before there's a rebalance. But I think there's always, from an economic standpoint, businesses have always got problems and challenges and pain points, and I think for us it's adapting and working out how we can support them navigating an environment where they're operating with 20% less staff than they typically would because they can't actually get staff. So how can we support them kind of navigating that environment as opposed to kind of just sitting back and saying, well, we're not in the industry of recruiting people, so kind of bad luck. And so I think it's, as a business, how you can kind of adapt and pivot a little bit to support them with whatever challenges they've got at a present point in time, because in 2 years' time, they're going to be completely different challenges.
I think the SMB has now gone past COVID. Their concerns are along the same lines as Winston Bong mentioned, how to grow their business. But they're not considering COVID as an issue at all anymore. They're just quite focused on how to grow their business. In fact, because of the fact that COVID is now over, they can actually step out and do things in a regular way, there is an increased, enhanced activity around businesses that even
the recovery period, how long is it going to take you to recover revenues that you lost during COVID?
Well, that was very difficult to say. On a hopeful note, I'd say maybe, hopefully, in about, if my son can deliver everything that he has promised, in 6 months.
6 months.
It's on you, Nicky.
I was going to say, I'm very much looking forward to the presentation. We'll have a spot presentation in 6 months to hold you accountable.
But then we're up for 6 months.
6 months is pretty ambitious.
I know, which is what I'm saying. Yeah. Well, hopefully, that's what I hope for. That's what I need to do. Because the problem we've had is the churn that we've had in the last couple of years. Didn't mean that I didn't have a churn as far as cost is concerned. My cost was basically almost the same, but my revenue dropped tremendously. And to be able to get that back. Same level. But anyway, that was what I said, hopefully. But realistically, I'd say about 18 months.
Yeah, okay.
Please. I almost feel guilty kind of sitting up on stage because I think as a country, Australia from a lockdown perspective was definitely locked down, but from a COVID case numbers perspective, because we were so heavily locked down, we didn't have huge volumes of kind of COVID cases that were ever out of control or anything like that. As an organisation, we work in the trades and services sector that could continue to operate throughout the pandemic. So I think our COVID experience was probably very unlike a lot of other companies' COVID experience, because for us, it was supporting our clients and helping them navigate that environment. They couldn't find enough staff to fulfil all the orders and all the work coming in. People were at home and they had a higher amount of disposable income because they weren't going out to the movies and going to the cinema or the theatres on the weekend. So everyone had a sort of high level of disposable cash and decided it was a good time to renovate the house or put a pool in the backyard and do different things. And so I think our kind of COVID experience and navigating through it and kind of out the other side has been an incredibly different journey to kind of a lot of other providers, because it has been more around that sort of supply chain issue, labour shortages, than it has been from kind of an economic or business impact.
So what's your revenue recovery if you didn't lose any revenue? How long is it going to take you to recover revenue in your company?
We weren't impacted from a revenue standpoint.
That's okay.
Yeah.
Can I just add? I just want to make a caveat, because it's not a question, moving forward, it's not a question that COVID's gone. Okay? What we're looking forward to right now in the Philippines is, we just hit the highest inflation in the last 5 years, and there's a threat of a recession. So, again, I believe it's just as big.
It's a whole different challenging time.
It's like a double whammy after you've got hit from COVID and you recover from that and you get hit with this. So
the economic bandit. The economic bandit.
I know. And political or whatever.
Thank you very much for coming.
Fortunately, we are in a business where we've always been prepared to work from home or work from any remote location for the last, 10 years. We've had services, software, securities, and cloud absorption, because that's what we do. We do fulfillment from Japan to Canada and the Philippines. So we actually work. A lot of our partners were not prepared. They were getting the orders. They had a lot of overflow orders to fulfill, but they didn't have staff to do it because of COVID. They were locked down. Italy had a big problem. And then it moved to England and then, of course, to Canada. And on all of the spaces, we actually grew our business. So in that sense, the first year of the pandemic, we were out there supporting the West countries, because COVID came to India 6 months later than it went around the world, right? China, Japan, and Italy, Iran, Middle East. And then that's when India was hit. So in the first year, we actually grew our business trying to support our customers. In the second year, it kind of stabilized, so we didn't really get growth, but we didn't lose on the revenue the biggest year.
Okay.
But I think kind of to that point, and a little bit different, is throughout COVID, everyone learned different things. And I think I was just sharing, like I said, an SMS update to my staff every Monday at 10 o'clock and kind of update them on what happened for the week. And they were kind of stand-ups and sessions we'd run in the office, but you embraced technology and you kind of did things differently. And I think as a business, you learn lots of different habits and ways of doing things, and some of those are going to stick and some of those maybe aren't going to stick, and depending on kind of what happens.
My next question was, because you obviously changed a whole lot of things during that period in order to survive, etc. And as we're now coming out of COVID, as most people are admitting we are, how many things are you going to continue doing that you introduced because of COVID that you see the value of even when you're not in COVID?
Well, there's just one really glaring thing as far as I'm concerned, which is what we've learned from COVID, and I believe I would like to continue, is instead of trying to, you know, go to a client, instead of trying to convert him, to convince him to do this or that, you enter his space. I'll give you an example. For example, he does his digital presence using Facebook. I won't tell him, hey, cancel your Facebook and set up our own website. I'm going to tell him, no, I'll help you boost your Facebook. I'll help you create content for your Facebook. And then along the way, I'll tell you, but this Facebook page does not give you a lot of things. You need a website to really explain what your company is all about. And that's basically how you slide yourself in. Something like that. I mean, and you know, you don't fight what the mindset of the client is. He's got that mindset already. I mean, that's how he got. He was not in the digital world. He decided to become in the digital world. And you just don't tell him, hey, you're wrong.
Positive thing that came out of COVID, I think all of our employees became far more empathetic and cared about the community, and we did lots of fundraising events and we supported kind of different causes, and I think a lot of those things internally for us have carried through. So it wasn't just kind of a moment in time, it was something that kind of ran the course, and it started with us kind of championing and helping businesses along the way because they kind of needed a leg up because of COVID. And then our people started to get involved, and then there was weather events in the Philippines, and we kind of all contributed and sent aid packs across to the Philippines to help out when the floods happened. And I think there's a lovely kind of human nature that's come out of it, and I think that for us has stuck around. But I think the nicest thing is it's actually not us that's doing it, it's kind of all of our people that have really kind of... So I think that for me is kind of a highlight, because it's a program of work that we've not needed to necessarily drive. It was kind of
a natural concept
that's kind of evolved throughout. And I think it is something beautiful about supporting not only our local community, but also kind of the global community.
I totally second what Lisa said. I think culturally we've grown a lot because of the pandemic. I think the word you used was empathy. I think that's what's been there. Because of the pandemic, we found our teams were supporting each other, they were supporting people in their own sort of geographical communities, and they were supporting customers in a way that we've never seen in the past. And that was not because of extra hours or overtime, it's just because it had to be done. That was the right thing to do. So I think from that perspective, we would say that the pandemic's been a positive thing, that the positive outcome of the pandemic's been teams getting closer and culturally become stronger. From a tech perspective, I don't think there's
people react, and how people will not just react, but will act in the social media world, especially in the Philippines, which is Facebook and Viber, the most popular things, is that people would put up messages, put up their own thoughts, what they think about certain things, okay, and you get a lot of response from people. And in our office, we're using Microsoft Teams to communicate among each other, and in the general page where you post to everybody, I would normally, it's on a weekly or even twice a week basis, come up with my certain posts about things. And interestingly, you get a response from people, then you engage with them. You communicate, you talk, I respond to their response, and then you have some kind of communication. So, yeah, to a certain extent, that was also helpful. Of course, not necessarily a replacement of face-to-face, but up to a certain extent, maybe better than a face-to-face, because with this one, I can send a message and everybody reads it. Okay, as I guess before, I would send a memo, and not everybody reads those memos. And you cannot write memos about just simple notes about what I think about this, what I think about that. You know. But good memos are supposed to be of important matters. You know. While in Teams, I can just put a phrase or something.
I've got different opinions on it. Some people saying that when people are sitting at home, how do I know that they're working? How do I know they're not taking the kids for a walk or they've just switched off? The other side of that is people say, no, in fact, it had a much greater impact on productivity. And that people were much more committed if they were not being watched.
On our end, it's not so much about watching them what to do, but we basically have KPIs on a more shorter period of time, which is like weekly or at least so many days, or per project, you're supposed to finish this on this date. So, whether you finish it while taking your child on a walk in the park, I don't care, as long as you finish the job successfully.
Sure. At least I think you said earlier that you found productivity increased.
Yeah, correct. And I think for us as an organization, and I think technology plays a big part in it, we were very much set up for COVID, and I was going to say potentially thankfully or not thankfully, in the 12 months leading up to COVID, our government in Victoria decided to replace all of the level crossings with either tunnels or overpasses, so there was no more kind of level crossings for our trains, which caused major disruption for some of our employees. So we decided to pilot out our disaster recovery plan, and actually instead of making someone whose commute was normally an hour into the office was going to turn into 3 hours, let's try and see if we can set those impacted people up remotely and get them testing and trialing things. And so in the lead up, in kind of the 12 months leading into COVID, we tested out our telephony platforms, we tested out our kind of operating systems, we tested out our reporting structures, and kind of tested so many different things to almost not thinking we'd necessarily have to implement it as quickly as we did. But for us, it was kind of fortunate that when we found out we thought it may happen, we kind of sent everyone home and we said, rightio, we're going to do a 48-hour test, the entire organisation's going to work from home. And as it happened, within that 48-hour test, we were kind of locked down, and what we thought was a 2-day test turned into...
3 years.
Well, it turned into 6 months, they let us out for a few weeks and they decided to lock us back up. So it was kind of the ebbs and flows. I think someone before was saying, I think we had 5 or 6 lockdowns in kind of over that 2-year period, but it gave us an ability to have at least tried and tested in advance. And I think the systems and things you use are really important, because I know from a coaching perspective, our call centre leaders, there's no difference with them coaching at home than what there is when they're coaching in an office. They can visually hear the call, they can see what's happening on the screens the consultant's using, they can call whisper and put messages into the consultant's ear while the consultant's on the phone. So there's ways in which you can embrace technology so that there is no physical difference to sitting in a call centre next to someone. somebody and having a conversation with them or doing it remotely.
So no change in leadership style, then?
No, not at all.
Yeah, right.
And obviously, like all things, working from home isn't for everybody. And I think you mentioned working from the office wasn't for everybody when they came back. But I think for us, it's been a really positive one because it was voted in by our staff and it was what they kind of wanted to have. So I think that's important as well.
You know, we believe that there's a difference in, you know, the two terms, ownership and leadership. So if you're a business owner, you think in one way, but if you're a business leader, you have to think in another way altogether. Our business is built around processes. So control comes from the processes, not from the people. And the systems that are there in place for monitoring that, both in terms of technology and in terms of, you know, the workflows. So from a leadership perspective, I think the only thing we really had to do was to be with people, to be available whenever there was a need for anything, and that could be just about anything, right? It could be somebody's mother who can take to the hospital and they need oxygen. It could be somebody needs transport, and we had some, you know, vehicles that were registered to be able to fly on the roads with the permit, and we would send them out. So anything and everything that was required to let people, to facilitate things for people in their troubled times is what we were focusing on. In terms of work, people were focusing on the work themselves. We didn't have to really worry about that because, as I said earlier, we are essentially an outsourcing company, so we've got those systems in place.
And I think the other one is just have fun. Like, if you're working from home and COVID was happening, you'd sit around virtually and play a quiz on a Friday afternoon when everyone had normally finished work and probably be on the way home, but we were in lockdown and we're at home, and so people made the most of it. We had baking competitions and different things that happened kind of throughout, and I think globally we've kind of embraced a global culture now that we're having Halloween competitions and pumpkin cutting competitions. We don't necessarily celebrate Halloween as much in Australia, but I think for us doing all of those things as well and making it fun.
Totally. You know, we started a movie club, people would, they have this app, Google Chrome, whatever that widget is, that allows people to share their screen and watch a movie together from their homes. And all of that kind of stuff was happening while COVID was at its peak. So I guess people found ways to engage themselves and have fun because that was the only thing to keep you sane.
Yeah. A little bit about some of the processes that you're using. I was wondering if you still were using those processes, and then I had a follow-up question afterwards.
No, perfect. So we, throughout the COVID pandemic, we'd started selling virtually. So had built packs and presentations to be able to navigate and kind of mimic a face-to-face experience in a virtual environment on Teams. And some of it was a bit of an education piece because everyone had to use technology. But actually, since COVID and since we've gone kind of back to normal, I've stood up a new channel in the business that sits between my call center and my face-to-face channel. And actually, I'm now servicing my top call center customers in a virtual face-to-face capacity because, for me, there was incredible merit in the work that came out of it at the other end of it. And so for those clients that were just sitting in a
call center, you know, creating a virtual assistant for your businesses as an upsell to service, that's a big area of opportunity.
So in the United States, so that really helped the inside sales groups to be able to use and become proficient various virtual sales methods in applications such as Zoom or Microsoft Teams. And they still use that very effectively in the United States. But we're seeing that the premise reps have gone away from that now that there's no many restrictions. They are doing more face-to-face. My follow-up question to this was, you brought up an interesting aspect. You know, we've gone through now what we thought would be a possible recession because of COVID and didn't really experience that. In fact, we had a lot of growth in the United States in the stock market and such. But now, because of inflation, it's a different problem. And I was just wondering what all of you were doing in regards to, and what if you're finding specific problems as you're now talking to customers that are fearful of inflation.
I think locally for us in Australia, the employment piece is still a bigger piece than the inflation piece for small business owners. I think the inflation piece is probably a bigger concern for our employees and their families, and I know people have kind of got mortgages and different things, what the kind of rising interest rates are going to do. But I think at a client level, we've still got such a skills shortage in some industries and such high demand that it's making it more important than ever to be able to fill those skill shortages so that they can kind of capitalize on what's coming through. So I think it is a real challenging one that I'm sure is going to evolve as kind of time plays out over the next little while.
One of the factors which I don't really understand, but there seems to be a shortage of skills and people in many, many industries, certainly from the gastronomic area, but also in the high skills area too. And I'm not sure I understand why that is the case, but it clearly is, in a number of countries. And is this your experience in finding good people now more difficult?
Well,
pre-COVID?
With us, it's not the question of finding good people in the first place. It's losing those good people in the first place because of what you said.
Okay.
And we figured out, we think we figured out what happened, in that the larger companies, who all had digital presence, realized their digital presence was a flat, two-dimensional website. All of a sudden, they realized they had to come up with something more robust.
Right.
Okay. Right. And what had happened is all these years, they never really paid attention. They just, many of these companies just thought, let's have a website. So they just get websites from many of these independent. Okay. Then they realize that as you, if they want to change anything, they have to get in touch with the developer. It's not like the new websites now, like wherein the users, the owners can change anything as they wish. So all of a sudden, they figured out they need people, which is the problem, because these are big companies, big conglomerates that can offer bigger salaries just to be able to get. And at least they do not have to train anymore people. They'll just hire the people because they don't have time to train. We don't have statistics on that. But personally,
they take your people. They take your people.
Yes. But that's just our experience. Well, not just when you say skill, not just, in fact, we're seeing a lot of this, not too much on our technical people, because we have always taken care of our technical people. But our salespeople, our top salespeople who have been with us for 5-7 years, are the ones during the pandemic, when the pandemic waned, are the ones who left. Means that the great resignation era.
And
we believe that's the rationale.
Okay.
I think ours was, and I think across the board in Australia, so I think the first 18 months of the pandemic, no one was leaving their employment. So if you were trying to recruit from vacancies, there wasn't the talent looking in market because everyone had that level of uncertainty, not knowing what was going to happen with the pandemic. I think fast forward then to kind of the start of 22, and there definitely was more people out in market, more people looking for roles. But I think as an employer, you really need to work on what is kind of the value proposition of working for you. What are those extra things that you do for your staff and give to your staff to help them, whether it be from a training and a development perspective, whether it be from kind of a work perks perspective, whether it be an investment in them and their mental health, and that you run mindfulness sessions or financial coaching. But what are all of those things that you're able to kind of offer your staff to make sure that you are an employer of choice? And I think that for us has probably been something that's been a greater focus throughout the pandemic. But I think the nice thing off the back of it is we continue to kind of survey our staff and get feedback from our staff from an employee engagement perspective. And I think the initiatives and things that we've put in place are all kind of off the back of things that our staff have wanted. So I think listening to them has been a really important kind of component of it. But I think from an overall perspective, the job industry is now starting to normalise in Australia from a labour skills shortage perspective, it definitely still exists.
There is a high demand of skill, right? And I think this problem is a global problem and a social problem. So there has to be a similar solution that will evolve over time. You just have to probably get used to the idea of people wanting to make choices, and you know they can leave a company on short notice. But in the first year of the pandemic, we actually reached an agreement with a major Canadian partner. Started up the work in April, the first year of the pandemic. We were hit by the pandemic in May. We were supposed to start deliveries in June. In 12 weeks or lesser, we recruited 100 people online and put them through training and started the deliveries on time. So it isn't that it's not possible. You could do it. And if you were looking, if you've got a good HR department, you can actually get the talent. The only thing is retention. So like Elise said, you've got to have all of those initiatives, but that's no guarantee that people will stay with you. But that is no reason that you will not have those initiatives. So yeah, we keep doing what we must do. And you know, a decision for a person to leave or to stay is most of the times their own individual decision, and it's also a function of their integrity. Because you find that engineers, when we hire engineers, even though we've got these two-year bonds and contracts, whatever else you may want to put up in place, they find a better job,